Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations, the Mobile Corporation, John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, Laurel Foundation, Sunstrand Corporation, and the Friends of Firing Line.
As this audience is aware, once or twice every year we have thought it fair to relinquish the investigative or prosecutorial function of this chair to the guests. The idea is that they will seek to explore the views of one American conservative and hold him accountable for those views and themselves accountable for their culture lag. We have here as executioners three very bright men, all of them familiar to our viewers. Mark Green is nowadays the president of a research institute which he calls the Democracy Project. He is a lawyer, a graduate of Cornell and of the Harvard Law School, which he left to go to work for Ralph Nader, so to speak, postgraduate training for the Harvard Law School. He was with Mr. Nader for 10 years and has written 10 books. The latest, Winning Back America, Practical Liberal Alternatives to Reaganism. The search for these alternatives has only just begun, like Reaganomics. Morton Kondracke is the executive editor of The New Republic, where he recently took over the column made famous by John Osborne called White House Watch. He is a graduate of Dartmouth and a former Nieman Fellow at Harvard. Michael Kinsley is the editor of Harper's. He was formerly editor of The New Republic. Before that, managing editor of the Washington Monthly. He is a graduate of Harvard, who did graduate work in economics at Magdalen College in Oxford, and then returned to Harvard to get his degree in law. Gentlemen, make yourselves at home.
Thank you, Mr. Buckley. Seduced once again by your charming introduction, let me ask an easy question. Something over 2 years ago, the most conservative candidate by my lights in decades gets elected president. With a 10-to-1 electoral college majority, he has what most people would agree are legislative majorities in both chambers, and there's a lot of talk about a Republican realignment. Not only he wins, but the Republicans start winning in 82 and thereafter. 2 years later, most polls show that he is less popular at this point in his term than any president since polls were begun to be taken since the 1940s, and the economy, many people I think would agree, is still in a mess. What happened? What went wrong, if indeed you think something went wrong?
Well, I think several things happened. A lot of people, you must be aware, are anti-inflation, but not anti-anything that is anti-inflationary that might affect them. This is not only true of people who work, it's true of people who manage. It's true of people who run great dairy combines, and it's true of the milk farmer. Mm-hmm. So that on the one hand, one is often very much enthused by the man who tells you that you have to enter into a regime to watch your weight, but then after a few weeks, you tend to rebel. This also, I think, is a result of a temptation we have all had in America, in particular, to assume that reform comes quickly. Mm-hmm. Notwithstanding our prolonged experience with the contrary, people felt that you could lick inflation and lick inflation and lick unemployment and lick most of the malaise as quickly as it would take to listen to one speech on the subject. That's just a few general.
Well, but do you expect unemployment now to fall to any acceptable level under the Reagan regime? He's got inflation down, but how is unemployment going to fall?
Well, is the operative word acceptable?
The operative word is important.
If there's one person unemployed who wants to work, that's important. But the level of acceptable unemployability has, in my lifetime, changed hugely. We had, of course, 10 or 12% unemployment under Roosevelt. Everybody agreed that was too much. Then it went down to 5%. They said that was too much during the Eisenhower years. But then, they came through with the concept of frictional unemployment, that in any healthy society, you got X number of unemployed. That oscillated between 3 and 5%. Then what, of course, happened in America was that women, in particular, decided they wanted to go to work. 37% of American women wanted to go to work in 1960. 51% wanted to go to work 20 years later. Now, during that period, America provided 27 million extra jobs, an interesting figure because it's 1 million more than the total workforce of West Germany, which declined by 1 million during that period. Now, whether or not Say's law is finely enough tuned to keep us one step ahead of the guy who wants to be employed, we just don't know. We do know that there isn't a better system, A, and B, we do know also, I think, this, that the rule of thumb has been in the past that for every 3% growth in GNP, you get 1% growth in demand for jobs. So that if between, say, now and the end of next year, i.e. 24 months from now, you get a rise in the GNP totaling, say, 9%, which is reasonable, you drop the unemployment down to about 8%. 1% worse than it was under Carter.
You got all those numbers memorized, Mort. Before you get off the hook completely on inflation, though, I think it's
true.
Who
said I was going to?
Oh, well, the subject changed unemployment briefly. It is true that the inflation rate has been Reagan's most dramatic success, or the most dramatic economic success of the past couple of years. The question is it Reagan's success or not? It seems to me that what has brought down the inflation rate was Paul Volcker and the tight money policy of the Fed.
Well, so you are a monetarist.
I think no one ever doubted that a tight money policy could cure inflation. Mm-hmm. The question is, was it worth the cost? And the question more specifically concerning the Reagan administration is, hasn't he, as I think, made the cost worse without really making the cure any more effective?
Well,
what is there in Reagan's policy of the past couple of years that had anything to do with bringing down the inflation rate?
I tell you, slowing down the rate of growth. See, the rate of economic growth, of economic spending by the federal government, was 17% the last year of Carter. For the first time in something like 8 or 9 or 10 years, it has slowed. And the slowing down of it may have had something to do with the contraction of inflation.
But this was not at all the theory behind Reaganomics. The theory behind Reaganomics was that we were going to have an economic expansion and that increased productivity was going to swallow up some of those percentage points.
Absolutely right. So you're absolutely right. And he was wrong, and so were all of the economists of Harvard. I hope you all three don't have to leave. so were all the economists of Yale, so were all the economists of Time and Newsweek. They were all plain wrong. Now, if they had been right, the contraction of the inflation alongside a budget deficit that would have been lessened by $35 billion per 1% of unemployed, or $140 billion, then what you're hitting at might have happened more quickly. Frankly, I don't think that Reagan ever went far enough to really lubricate the juices. Just to dispose of your question, I think that you are correct that what happened, he didn't anticipate. Was it his fault ideologically? Absolutely not, because there was no liberal in the world who anticipated what happened.
No, wait, there was. James Tobin predicted at the very outset of the Reagan administration that this thing would not work, that Reagan was on the one hand stimulating the economy with fiscal policy and at the same time suppressing the economy with monetary policy, and that there was two locomotives headed in the opposite direction. And in fact, the monetary policy won. We are in the deepest recession since the Great Depression, and what I was asking you is how we are going to get out of it under Reagan. How you are going to get unemployment down. You say that we're going to grow at, what, 6%?
Okay, just for the record, you're not telling me that Mr. Tobin anywhere published that he anticipated that the recession would reach this level, are you? Because if so, I've never seen that.
He said in the New Republic that this would not work. I'm not sure that he predicted the numbers, but he said it would not work.
Not only James Tubman, but surely he would admit that many people, many liberals especially, pointed out the inherent contradiction in Reaganomics, that
even George Bush did.
Supposed to be an expansion for growth and a contraction for inflation, monetary policy, fiscal policy, and that the two notions were inherently contradictory. No one predicted that, as Morton said, monetary policy would win out so overwhelmingly. But you have to
remember that it is a paradox formally stated as you do. It would have been much less so if the initial calls for substantial tax reduction had gone through. If we hadn't waited until October, if we hadn't cut in half the tax reduction, if there had been the flow of compensatory money dating back to the 1st of January 1981, that might easily have made up precisely what you point to as the incongruity.
But isn't this economic revisionism? In the summer of 81, we all recall how Ronald Reagan and Don Regan said, we've got 95% of our economic package through. The president said, I now promise you, with this in place, we'll have economic recovery. And what bothers me, other than the pain in vain, I mean, there's been all these cuts of social programs without the promised economic growth, is that the president is such an artful buck passer. It's never his fault. It's always a prior president's fault. Or when he said, it's such a marvelous construct, and I like your opinion of it, when he said, all right, I'll take responsibility for 3 points of the unemployment. Since I came in, it was 7.2, and now it's over 10. If they, the Democrats, take responsibility for the 7.2% unemployment when I came into office, I did a little research, and the prior four Republican presidents...
You're going to ruin your reputation.
Like you. I can't farm it out. And of four prior Republican presidents, they had a net increase in unemployment of 10.5 points. The three prior Democratic presidents had a reduction in unemployment of 3 points. So even his attempt to pass the buck to prior Democrats is factually
inaccurate. You didn't go back to
inaccurate.
Roosevelt.
No, modern presidents.
Well, I think we all know that economics is inexact. I think we also know that all politicians tend to graduate their rhetoric so that a validity becomes a certitude. I happen to regret this. I do think that it is a pity that Mr. Reagan hasn't shown the steel I'd have liked him to show in the discipline with which he was flirting. Now, whether this is because he is a man lacking in moral stamina, explanation number one, or whether he has run into the kind of impacted resistance that people like you have generated during your lifetimes is an interesting question.
And like the Senate majority.
Since I know both contenders, I would say it was likelier the latter than the former.
But do you really think?
I'm flattered. I think the Senate majority had more to do with slowing down his program than I did.
Well, sure, they're all politicians. And the Senate majority...
As probably, Mr. Reagan.
For instance, suppose Reagan had said, the top tax has got to go down to 25%. Nobody should be taxed more than 25% under any circumstances, and let's forget any other changes. Everything else stays the same.
Right.
How much revenue would be forfeited?
Well, since we've lost...
Do you know? 13%.
Right.
Now,
since we've lost $350 billion,
would you have expanded the base sufficiently to have made up that 25%? That 13%, in my judgment, there seems to be no doubt that it would have instant, not day after tomorrow, tomorrow, so that this would have done the kind of lubrication
that would have been consistent.
So, in
other words, you're saying that the supply side medicine
didn't go far enough.
Oh,
the problem.
Course.
The right. problem. Yeah. The problem. After all,
the New Dealers said exactly the same thing.
Right. So
Keynesianism would have worked if it had gone far enough. They might have been right.
So a $500 billion deficit may have been the result rather than Arthur Laffer's $200 billion.
My point is, there would not have been a deficit.
No, that was Arthur Laffer's point also. And it failed at the cuts that Reagan implemented. And you're allowed to go further.
The problem with Reagan's, the results of Reaganomics are not that what Reagan predicted didn't happen as much as he predicted. The problem is that the exact opposite happened. So when you now contest...
He predicted there would be a decline in inflation, which is exactly what happened.
Look, he predicted that had nothing to do with Reagan. That had to do with the Federal Reserve.
He called for a 30% tax cut, individual tax cut, right? He got 25% individual tax cut.
Postponed.
Postponed for a short time. All right, but now you can't really say...
If you had paid that tax, you might not have considered it a short time.
But
the fact of the matter is that it ran right into a progressive recession. So just at the moment when this money was necessary, wasn't there? And also we had the inertia of the preceding year's inflation. So that the year one tax cut was a negative tax cut. That is to say, people paid more in 1981 than they paid under Carter.
Now wait,
when
now
you
just
cut the bracket creep and you cut inflation.
Not, okay, but not, just the, not the people who you're most concerned about, the people in the top brackets.
What makes you think I'm most concerned about them?
They're the ones whose rate you wanted to reduce down to 25%.
Well, it's true that they are the ones who agitate most strongly to avoid tax exposure. But they is 37 million Americans, i.e. the people who pay more than 25% on the marginal
but they're
dollar. And they're the people who start the cozying up to their brother-in-law, who is otherwise an utter bore, and say, is it true that you know how to avoid paying 35% tax or 40% tax or whatever? And those are the people whose decisions amount to a misallocation of $500, $600, or $700 billion per year.
Now, one of Ronald Reagan's other promises was that this gigantic growth that he was going to set off on with tax cuts would balance the budget almost without any need to cut domestic programs. He gets into office and begins slashing away at domestic programs, and lo and behold, with his wonderful program, we now have budget deficits coming in at $200 billion this year and stretching out to $300 billion in future years. Now, what kind of a conservative is that?
Well, it's certainly not conservative to act like a Democrat. And most Democrats, like Mr. Carter, are always promising aid and unemployment and inflation and everything, including the United States. And I don't think he should have done that. It is a circle-squaring expedition to attempt to promise or to promise that which in fact cannot be delivered. But I'm interested now in the discipline of what might have happened. Mm-hmm. We know that a recession unanticipated by Democratic theologians is costing us $135 billion a year. Now, if in fact the tax deductions had equaled that which the theorists said they ought to equal, are you so sure that we wouldn't have had a balanced budget?
Well, not with the monetary policy that he imposed.
No.
The recession may have occurred anyway, but his monetary policy, or the Volcker monetary policy, which he aided and abetted, has...
Now, wait a minute.
And cheered.
Mr. Kondracke, please. In the first place, he didn't appoint Volcker. In the second place, he has complained to Volcker. In the third place,
Volcker really?
has often expressed his independence. So how come all of a sudden a Carter appointee becomes Reagan's...
Reagan doesn't deserve credit for the
Mr. Buckley, for years, Mr. Reagan has said that Milton Friedman is his favorite economist, he who is known for many things, most especially his monetarist theory. And in the beginning, during the campaign and his early presidency, Mr. Reagan, supported by word, Mr. Volcker's tight money policy, and he got what he wanted, which is lower inflation
in the first place,
and 50% higher
unemployment
rate. It's going
to be confusing. Now you're arguing with Mr. Kinsley. Mr. Kinsley just finished saying that he acknowledges that a tight money policy reduced inflation.
I didn't argue with
which
that.
Which was conceded by everybody who answered Mr. Gallup in 1980 as the nation's number one
but it
problem.
Did it
that
by causing this recession that you're calling
no.
unanticipated.
We're urging Mr. Reagan and you to, if you're going to take credit for lower inflation because of tight money, take credit, will you, for the higher unemployment. We've traded double-digit inflation for double-digit unemployment, and we could discuss the morality of that, but I wish he would not take credit for inflation and then make like he's not president when unemployment goes up.
But let's just clean up the Friedman business, because as Friedman said last week in Time magazine, if Mr. Volcker's policies are monetarism, I am not a monetarist,
right.
Because that which distinguishes them is that Mr. Friedman believes in an absolutely predictable, slow, organically related rate of monetary expansion, whereas Mr. Volcker tends to be a gymnast up this week, down this next week, causing, in that marvelous metaphor, the man who couldn't understand why his brother had died, crossing a creek, the average depth of which was only 4 feet. So that don't indict thoughtlessly monetarism just in this general
But if Milton Friedman had been running things, let us assume it would be done differently. The monetary policy would be smoother, but also the inflation rate would be higher today because Milton Friedman would be reducing the inflation rate more gradually. You know, there's this very, very discredited liberal concept, the Phillips curve, which measures the trade-off between inflation and recession and unemployment. And the supply-siders, the conservative economists, have been saying this is a terrible liberal thing. We must break through this and change this trade-off. And this is what supply-side economics was supposed to do. And essentially, what has happened is we have not changed this trade-off one bit. We have just moved to a different place on the curve.
What makes you think that you've tried supply-side economics? Look, as of this moment, please take my word for it, and if you don't, call up your favorite research service or call up the federal government and ask them whether the average American is better off this moment than he was in 1960 in terms of taxes. The answer is he's not. There has been the bracket creep, there has been inflation, less, but there's been some, and there's been higher Social Security taxes, with the result that there has not been a higher propensity to consume, presumably transcends the ability to save, but the fact of the matter is that there hasn't been any substantial supply-side economics tried.
Let me just look to the future now. Ronald Reagan does face 11% unemployment. Do you anticipate that a year from now, this economy will be in marginally better shape than it is now? Do you, and what do you expect the growth rate to be, and how do you expect it to come about?
Well, I think it's not easy to predict what Mr. Volcker will do, and I agree with Mr. Kinsley that what he does do will have a considerable effect on the economy. Now, if, let's say, a month from now, there's a kind of a jittery feeling in the market, in the bond market, and people smell inflation off there, it may very well be that Volcker will all of a sudden apply those massive brakes, in which case a scheduled recovery might be aborted. So that just as he has released the brakes too dramatically in the past, he's likely to apply them too rigidly in the future. So I wouldn't predict. I do think this, that somebody used the metaphor of the rubber band. The harder you fall, the greater tension there is to rise in an economy that is essentially healthy, which...
You think this economy is essentially
healthy? Essentially, yeah.
How is it then that every time we have a recovery, the recovery is weaker than the one that preceded it, and every time we have a recession, unemployment is higher than it was in
taxes,
the last one?
Mostly taxes.
Don't you think it's structural? I mean, don't you think that taxes are not the whole of the structure of the economy.
No,
we have products,
no,
we have
not.
Industries that are obsolete, and we've got to replace them somehow.
That's right. I couldn't agree with you more. And but taxes is one of the reasons why we don't. We save one half what the Germans do, one third what the Japanese do. We tax the investment dollar 24%, the Japanese tax at 11%. Now, given that, it is extremely hard to crank up the capital to revitalize the smokestack industries. They are in part because of that, in part for other reasons. For instance, the power of labor unions to make this very difficult. We have a great crisis coming up this summer in the steel industry. We may or may not be an ex-steel-making country after this summer.
We talked about this before, but isn't it right we are the least taxed Western economy, including Japan, both capital and individual? You may say it's greater than 1960 in real terms. It is. Social Security is more expensive, and we're paying for that. But compared to other capitalist nations, I think we're the least taxed.
Well, this is an abstruse debate, the terms of which fluctuate depending on whether you count in Medicare. If you count in Medicare, we are taxed higher than any country except Denmark and Sweden. And their economy is not doing too well, although they have working for them a certain homogeneity of a cultural nature that makes things a little easier than it does for us.
So far, we're having the discipline of a presidential press conference where you're supposed to exhaust all questions on one subject before moving on to another.
You want to go to
let
foreign
me just
affairs?
Move on to another, if we could. On foreign affairs, let me ask a question about the nuclear freeze, which is still current, and most people expect it to pass the new House, the 98th Congress, this next few months. I understand that you and the president are not big supporters of what's called the Kennedy-Hatfield bilateral freeze.
Support any idiocy.
Fine. you can get to your adjectives, but I hope you get to your facts. I want to ask you a factual question.
Idiocy is a noun.
I want to ask you a factual question. But we can get to the merits of it, but I want to ask you about the president's characterization. I'm not surprised that he, the president, who's opposed every arms control a treaty with the Soviet Union in 20 years, supported by Republican and Democratic predecessors, doesn't like Kennedy Hatfield. What does surprise me is that
he repeatedly
says... Wasn't he right? Let me finish the question.
Okay.
It's yours. Show you plenty of time.
Okay.
I'm not going to cut you off. He reiterates that the people who support the freeze, which polls show to be a majority of the public, are dupes of the Soviet Union, and that the Kremlin is manipulating the freeze movement. Now, isn't this tactics and guilt by association? Has he said it? Do you agree with him?
But now, wait, look, he didn't say that everybody who's in favor of the freeze is an instrument of Soviet policy. What he said, which is exactly correct, is that international Soviet organs of opinion are highly mobilized on this particular issue. It doesn't take more than 10 minutes examination of Gromyko's grand tour through West Germany to recognize this is exactly what he's up to.
Do you think the Kremlin is manipulating the freeze?
To what extent he influenced you, I don't know. I would say maybe 20%, 25%.
This is fascinating. Yeah. When Pat Harris, in the presidential campaign in 1980, said the Klan today endorsed Mr. Reagan, the implication being Mr. Reagan was a racist, there was a lot of criticism of her, justifiably, that the Klan or you or my mother-in-law supports Mr. Reagan doesn't tell us much about what he believes. When he says that the Kremlin is behind and manipulates the freeze movement, is that not McCarthyism and smear tactics?
I would say that if the Klan had been as powerful in America as the Soviet Union is in international affairs, it would not by any means have been a discreditable statement. It would have been an extremely interesting one, because the Klan obviously stood to play a major role in precisely the debate in which we were engaged. But the Soviet Union is the critical other side of the tango in the matter of disarmament.
And how they attempt to
manipulate the policies of Western Europe is extremely important. Hitler was moderately good at it, but not nearly as good as Soviet
Union. So just to conclude this point.
And even he succeeded in disarming France.
If there was not one Russian or Soviet agent in the United States territory, are you saying that the American freeze movement would be substantially weaker, since Mr. Reagan said they were in part behind it? Hypothetical.
Oh, sure.
It would be much weaker.
Yeah.
They wouldn't have gotten a million people to Central Park in June 12th.
These things are difficult to measure,
right?
Because after all, the Rolling Stones might have gotten twice that many people. The fact of the matter is that the Soviet Union's the strength, when you consider its intimidating leverage, ought never to be discounted. So that a lot of people who fear nuclear war fear it more when the people in the Kremlin rattle their sabers. And under the circumstances, they might be mobilized in the sense that they weren't mobilized when they didn't rattle their sabers.
Sort of like Pavlov's dogs, is that what you think?
To a certain extent. I mean, Pavlov's, the point about Pavlov is that it worked, right? He proved something about dogs that are true, and the whole point of it wasn't because he was interested in dogs, it was because he was interested in people.
But surely, when President Reagan is saying that the Soviets are influencing the nuclear freeze movement, he doesn't have in mind that they're influencing the nuclear freeze movement by rattling their sabers. He means they're just the opposite, that they're influencing it by talking peace and possibly more insidiously by infiltrating
various peace groups. It's a combination. The lead piece in the New York Times this morning referred to the remarkable performance of Andrei Gromyko in West Germany, in which he alternately threatened and seduced. It is the old way of doing things, and it is the best way of doing things. To say, if you're not good, I'll punish you, and anyway, be good because we love you.
Okay, to follow that up, though, you are not asserting, and you don't hear the president asserting, that the Soviets have agents planted in major positions in the nuclear freeze movement in the United States. You're talking about public relations and diplomacy.
I would think it entirely likely. I mean, surely any nation that can that can fly satellites can plant an agent in an American bureaucracy.
Okay, but
there's a long string of people, after all, who have been discovered.
The notion that the freeze movement in the United States is manipulated by the Soviet Union has two meanings, as we've discussed. One is that people who are the leaders of the movement are direct agents of Moscow, and the other is that by skillful diplomacy, the Soviet Union is managing to affect American public
opinion.
There
may or may not be agents among a manipulable mass. Now, as you can take 1,400 school children and have the Beatles manipulate them, let's say in the direction of eroticism or in the direction of antinomianism, where you like. You can also have a claque in there of paid agents of the Beatles who start things going.
So it's both?
So it's both, yeah.
Okay.
It's neither one necessarily nor the other.
Now, let me ask you, what do you think the influence of the Reagan administration has been on the nuclear freeze movement when you have the President of the United States not knowing whether nuclear war plans call for demonstration shots over Europe, when you have the Secretary of State saying that the war plans do call for demonstration shots, when there is this ridiculous plan to evacuate the cities and have everybody chase off to Vermont in the event of nuclear war? Don't you think that the Reaganites have scared people about the possibility of nuclear war in a way, instead of educating them, have scared them and have helped do Moscow's work?
Well, I think they've scared mostly people who are anti-Reagan. Some people look for opportunities to be put off, and it's correct that the bureaucratic confusion done by James Carter tends to annoy me more than bureaucratic confusion done by Ronald Reagan. But bureaucratic confusion characterized the government of Abraham Lincoln, characterized the government of Pericles. So I expect to continue to see it. Now, the one thing probably that scares people whose threshold of fright is very high is that Mr. Reagan would unquestionably resist an aggressive nuclear attack by the Soviet Union with a counterattack. I don't think anybody in the world doubts it. Now, I happen to think this is the profoundest protective wall that we have. The moment the Soviet Union doubts that there would be an American response, our danger, I think, heightens. So the people who think it through, I think, would be less scared than otherwise.
Before I let your audience hear you talk about the potential Soviet manipulation of the freeze movement, does it educate your bias at all that the House Intelligence Committee, in a 300-page report, came to this conclusion? Quote, the bottom line is there is no evidence that the Soviets direct, manage, or manipulate the nuclear freeze movement. You hypothesize they could. They could. We could manipulate them. But they decide, as a factual inquiry, that they don't.
Well, I think that's absolutely anti-intellectual, if I may say so. Mm-hmm. It would be like
evidence is anti-intellectual?
It would be like my saying, T.S. Eliot did not influence modern poetry. And then you would say, well, what do you mean? I said, well, where's a check from T.S. Eliot to any modern poet?
Well, Mr. Buckley, if I can cite some evidence for my position, and you've cited no evidence but a hypothetical, I prefer evidence to a hypothetical.
Okay, I'll give you evidence that there are atomic spies. There are people like Blount. There are people like Burgess and Maclean. There are people who throughout 30 years have in fact been observable and detected agents of Soviet policy. I've written about some of them in my own novels.
You earlier said that some of the earlier arms treaties were insane.
Must be true.
You supported Mr. Nixon in 1972 for president over George McGovern. Or did you vote for Mr. McGovern?
I supported W.C. Fields.
I agree. I understand. I'm sure of that. Mr. Nixon supported and got past SALT I. Do you think Mr. Nixon was insane when he supported that arms control agreement, which you call insane?
Well, no, I thought SALT I was a gravely defective instrument.
Insane? That was your word.
Well, when did I say it?
Early when I said three arms control treaties, you said, well, of course you oppose insanity. Rather elegant. I thought I'd come back to
it. Well, don't you really think, as you reflect on it, don't you really think that the notion of mutual assured destruction, when the other way we might have gone, would have been to protect human beings through an anti-ballistics missile was a historic wrong turn? I really honestly think it was. In 1972, we renounced ABM, mm-hmm. and that's the only interesting part about SALT I, because SALT I did not lead to disarmament. When SALT II proposed, there was much, much more armament around than there was in SALT I. Mm-hmm. So therefore, it didn't accomplish anything except to immobilize ABM. Mm-hmm. That was the great lasting fingerprint of SALT I, and I think it was catastrophic.
And SALT II would have put a lid on the number of missiles and the number of warheads. You were against that, too.
Oh, but you see, a lid, Mr. Kondracke, is really uninteresting. If you and I sit here with, as the cliche has it, enough explosive power to blow ourselves up 8 times, I don't think it really matters if we accumulate enough power to blow ourselves up 10 times.
Okay, so why aren't you for a freeze, then?
Well, because what matters a lot, however, is that the compensatory character of the United States armory be prepared to handle contingent strikes here of this character or they or that character. Now, in Western Europe, we are defenseless. There's no way we can cope against a theater of nuclear aggression. Look, the Soviet Union comes up with 160 intermediate missiles, mm-hmm. and President Carter says, this is intolerable. We've got to deploy a theater of nuclear weapons. Today, they have 340 nuclear missiles, mm-hmm. and Mr. Reagan is considered to be intransigent because he doesn't consider that a return to the status quo ante is a satisfactory settlement.
Okay, but in Europe, the president has proposed the zero option, which was a good public relations and perhaps negotiating ploy to begin the negotiations. But now, even such intellectual soulmates of yourself as Franz Joseph Strauss are saying that this is absurd and
what's absurd?
That the zero option cannot be sustained. Because we have no missiles at the present moment. The Soviets do have these 350. There's got to be a deal somewhere in between rather than zero on their part and zero on ours.
Why?
Because
theoretically, we're sovereign along with the West Germans over West Germany, are we? Are we going to let the Soviet Union describe what it is that we're permitted to do in a defensive nature? Are you willing to make that concession?
The problem is, and this is a whole different area, that European public opinion, which we have got to depend upon to allow the missiles in, won't go for a full complement of 572 missiles.
Maybe they've been manipulated.
Missiles. Pardon me?
Maybe they've been manipulated.
I think they probably have been manipulated.
I think they have too. But the point is that we've got 350,000 American troops over there, and it's hard enough to defend Key West.
So now we've
undertaken to defend Western Europe. Yeah. We oughtn't be asked to defend Western Europe without being permitted to do so. And if Western Europe is saying, in effect, just hang on to your submarines and all those things back there, and don't trouble us, we simply have to say to them, this won't work. Mm-hmm. And after all, Mr. Reagan is not saying anything that Mr. Carter
This won't work.
Oh, no, there's one thing he's saying very differently. He is saying we are militarily inferior to the Soviet Union overall and in terms of nuclear weapons. Do you agree with that statement, Mr. Reagan's?
I don't know, because I don't know enough about BB shots. I know that there's no question that we're militarily inferior in that part of Europe, and we're certainly militarily inferior in terms of our capacity to mobilize a quick tactical force, say, in the Gulf of Hormuz.
Sure, we are superior and they are superior in different weapons and regions. But overall, he said that we are number two to the Soviet Union. And
I think probably most schooled military people would say that. They got greater throwaway.
Isn't that a very self-defeating thing to say, even if you think it's
right.
true, since the whole point of deterrence, which you articulated just a while ago, is to make it clear that we are not inferior. So even if you think we are, isn't it foolish for someone like President Reagan or a supporter like yourself to go around saying
I think it's self-defeating for you to say the supply side economics won't work.
Because of expectations.
That's fair. By the way, you had said most experts agree with that. Do you know any member of the past or current Joint Chiefs of Staff who agree that we are militarily inferior? I don't.
I do.
Who are they? Yes?
Bud Zumwalt. Next question.
the man who ran for Republican Senator in Virginia?
Does that disqualify his military judgment?
Did he say it while he was
considered the most?
Did he say it while he was on the Joint
Admiral?
Chiefs of Staff? Every member of the current Joint Chiefs, when asked this, said he wouldn't trade our military capacity for the Soviet Union. The consensus, by the way, you and I can't figure this out on firing line, actually. Mm-hmm. But the consensus among our current military establishment is that we are superior to the Soviets.
Well, look, that might be on the order of saying that our potential reserves are superior, but if you take into account that theirs is an offensively trained mm-hmm. Resource, which is prepared to act on its own initiative, whereas we are prepared to act on it defensively, and if we take into account that they've got enough stuff right there in East mm-hmm. Germany and Poland to obliterate Europe with intermediate weapons, and we have virtually nothing, that gives you some idea of what it is that we want to
Let me go into the political area of all of this and ask you about the state of health of the Western alliance. There are various theorists who believe that Europe is pulling away from the United States, that the NATO alliance is dissolving. I wonder if you share that apprehension.
I do. Yes, I definitely should. I think that the overwhelming majority of Europeans are nationalists and desire their own independence, but we do have this melancholy record of the 20th century in which their desire for independence didn't quite match the challenge to it, for instance, by Hitler. And that under the circumstances, that plus the castrating influence of the left in those countries has simply not made them very reliable. Harold Macmillan was on this program a year or so ago, and he said, frankly, I don't know what the Americans are doing in Europe. I personally am glad that they are in Europe. But he said, in Europe, we have more population than you do, and we have more wealth than you do. Why do we need you to defend us? The answer is, well, you shouldn't. But given the cultural lassitude on the matter of defense, we find it on the whole cheaper to do more than our share than to try to rescue them again, as we have done twice in this century.
And therefore, we should do what?
Well, therefore, I think that the great watershed is coming up real fast on this matter of theater and nuclear weapons. The probability, I think, is high that if we're ready to go and they are not ready to accept us, notwithstanding that they encourage us to do it and that they told us to go ahead and do it, what's going to happen is there will be a gradual rise of isolationist sentiment, and that something on the order of what Mike Mansfield has been calling for 7 years will begin to happen, i.e. a withdrawal of American troops from
and you,
Europe.
You wouldn't look forward to that with any pleasure.
Well, I don't know what you mean by
Well, let me ask,
pleasure.
I mean...
I've got a couple of nephews over there. I'd be glad to see them again. In that sense, I'd be pleased. I would not at all be pleased in the sense that I think that it intensifies the danger of the political satellization of Europe by the enemy.
But I mean, I think a lot of Americans are asking, and I wonder what your answer would be. Why should we be subsidizing their lassitude, as you call it?
It's cheaper.
Well, if I should, but I mean, as an analogy, if I were to show you a welfare family that had been living on the dole for many, many years, and Jack Kemp came along and said, "You see that family? If we cut back on their welfare, the father will come back from wherever he's gone, or the mother will go out and get a job, and we are just subsidizing their lassitude." And then I come along and I say, "Well, if we create a job for the mother, do we do anything like that? It's more expensive. It's easier just to leave her there." I don't think you'd think too much of that argument. Now, why should we be subsidizing the lassitude of these foreigners?
Well, there's no
if they don't want to pay their own way, why should we pay it for
there's,
them?
There's no moral reason why we should, but the stakes are different in the two examples that you gave. The reason Senator Moynihan gave for turning away from the Family Assistance Program is that experiments with it, he concluded, had the effect of intensifying human misery rather than alleviating it, had the effect of separating the mother from the father and causing deracinated families with very poor morale. That's why he finally came out against a program which he invented way back in 69. Now, in the case of Europe, we are not making really a moral point by saying you don't deserve to be helped if you're not willing to help yourself. We're simply saying it's cheaper for us to bear your burden or part of your burden than to see the whole of West Europe satellized in the next 4 or 5 years and us really isolated.
So they're essentially, you're letting them hold themselves hostage until we ransom them, in essence. The West European governments.
No, this would be unfair because they do have a sizable troop commitments. The military budget of England and of France is substantial. France has a force of five, it has 7 submarines. So it is as though they're totally quiescent. They're just simply not doing their share. Japan has huge national debates over whether to devote 1% of their GNP. To the military, you know, 15 Toyotas is about the scale in which they do it. Therefore, they're mooching on us. I don't think they ought to be permitted to do so. On the other hand, I don't want to pull out of South Korea because we want to indulge a snit against Japanese pacifists.
Let me change the subject again ask you about the health of your movement, the conservative movement. The new right, the hard right wing of your movement is talking about splitting off from Ronald Reagan, possibly running a candidate against him, Jesse Helms or Lou Lehrman or somebody of the sort.
William Buckley.
William Buckley is not the new right, I don't think. I mean, do you feel your movement fragmenting before your very eyes?
There's always a certain amount of angelism in any political movement in which ideas and purities tend to dominate. It happens to the left constantly. The history of the left is the history of Mensheviks versus Bolsheviks and so on and so forth. And it's also true of the right. And there's a sense in which, to the extent that Mr. Reagan fails to fulfill the promises of the paradigm, certain people will turn against him. Now, this is not entirely unhealthy. When Norman Thomas every now and then threatened Franklin Delano Roosevelt, certain people who have written about it said that, well, Norman Thomas really was pro-Roosevelt, but he felt that only if he threatened him would he continue to exercise the magnetic influence that he desired to exercise on that movement to keep it in, roughly speaking, in the left direction. Probably the new right's up to the same thing, wouldn't you guess?
Do you think they have an operative role, though? That is, would their threat affect Mr. Reagan's decision to run again or not? Or are they such a minority of a minority party that Mr. Reagan can politically ignore them?
No, I don't think he really can. Nixon told me something one time that is kind of interesting. This was 1967. He said, I found out in California in 1962 that you can't win a major election with just the right wing, but you can't win without it.
Right.
And I think that Mr. Reagan recognized this, but he's very, very far away from a broad disaffection.
Actually, Mr. Reagan once said in another context that a good politician will always have his or her constituency a little annoyed with him or her. If they're totally satisfied, you're not maximizing votes. I'm not defending that statement, I'm just reciting it.
That's the sort of the politician's equilibrium, that everybody should be slightly sore at you. I tend to think there's a little bit too much of a cliche like this. Sort of like English left Toryism. The leader really, I think, occupies a position and persuades people that it is a position that they should proudly defend. And that's what one hopes that Mr. Reagan, before he's through,
will have done. Do you think he'll run again? Do you think Mr. Reagan will run again?
Gee, I don't know. Most people do. There are, in his case, his reasons. His age is certainly one of them, why he would not want to do so.
Do you hope he does?
It would depend on the situation at the time.
Would you?
His own spirit, his own morale.
If he didn't, who would you think the conservative movement ought to follow? Jesse Helms, Jack Kemp, William Armstrong? Who are the...
Lewis Lehrman.
Bill Rusher.
George Bush?
Ought to follow freights the word ought to with too much baggage, because are you asking me who do I think could both be satisfactory to me and win, or are you asking me who is most satisfactory to me because of the ideas he has spoken?
Oh, take
both. You can take them one at a time.
Ken Galbraith always says, I'm in favor of the leftward most viable candidate. That's his stock phrase. I'm in favor of the rightward most viable candidate.
Who is the right?
But I don't know who's viable until post-New Hampshire. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. But well, could you see yourself ever supporting Jesse Helms for president in the Republican Party?
Well, why not?
Well, I don't know. Maybe he's got too much baggage. Maybe he's got...
He's for the
I certainly suggest. Couldn't find myself doing it, but I wonder if you you have a high tolerance, perhaps.
Well, yeah, we're a nation of very tolerant people. We've supported people like McGovern and Jimmy Carter. If one focuses only on those aspects of somebody which are abrasive, one can find those. I mean, my God, Lyndon Johnson must be the most abrasive human being. I never met him, but he must be one of the most abrasive human beings in the whole world. I mean, Mr. Cairo has spent 7 years discovering just the first 35 years of those.
The only thing is...
And Helms is abrasive, but Helms tends to be abrasive. Did you notice, by the way, that when Helms filibustered a few weeks ago, all the press talked about this ghastly man with how he delayed business. And the same press, the same day, referring to the filibusters of Senator Katzenbaum, Metzenbaum referred to this sort of melancholy man trying to do his duty, though all the pressures were on him, but
That's not complete. There, people pointed out that anomaly at the time, I think.
Yeah, I thought it got kind of nice. Yeah. But I think that in other circumstances, Senator Helms would be viewed differently.
Mm-hmm. What's your opinion of the populist drift of Richard Viguerie and other persons on the new right? which includes protectionism and anti-immigration sentiment, which borders on racism, frankly, anti-Mexican, anti-Japanese, also extensively anti-establishmentarian. That is to say, your friends, the corporate tycoons, will be accused by this group of trading with the enemy, lending money to foreigners who don't pay it back. I mean, what is your general impression of that whole populist drift?
Gee, you packed kind of a lot into that.
Right.
In the first place, I hadn't known that they were flirting with protectionism.
Don't you get their mail?
Have they been manipulated by Walter Mondale?
Oh, well, he's
does he have spies in there?
he should be ashamed of himself. But protectionism has been a part of that tradition all along.
Protectionism is anathema to any genuine conservative, in my judgment, and has been since it was denounced by our godfather. Back in the 18th century.
Who was that? Which godfather?
I'm usually wearing his tie by this time, but
Adam Smith?
Adam Smith. He made the most powerful case, which in my judgment survives, against protectionism. I think, I think nothing could hurt us more than protectionism at any level. On the matter of immigration, I do think we have to control immigration. But to say that immigration is anti-racist because it's anti-Mexican is really the equivalent of saying that you're you are preoccupied not with people who are completely subverting our immigration laws, but with the fact that they are Mexican.
Well, there is
This, I think, is unfair.
It is possible to take positions in favor of protectionism, against immigration, or for cutting back on immigration that are not racist, even in flavor. But I think you have to recognize, if you're going to be realistic and evaluate these things in their cultural context, that there is a heavy xenophobic flavor to these to the writings of the new right populace on this issue. Just to throw out a statistic, we import almost as many cars from Canada as we do from Japan, but you don't hear anyone. The whole flavor of the anti-imported car rhetoric takes on about Japan.
But are some of those cars Chryslers?
What?
And Fords.
From Canada.
I
assume.
No, I think that the point that you make would be more easily dramatized if the Canadian cars were known to be Canadian owned. That is to say, if they were as distinctively Canadian as a Japanese car or Japanese.
Well, they're built by people whose jobs are in Canada, and those jobs are certainly distinctively Canadian.
Yeah, it's hard to mobilize American sentiment against a Ford. In the first place, most people don't even know it was made in Canada, right? Mm. But a Toyota was obviously made in Japan, although it might have been made in Pennsylvania, a few of them. But in the matter of Mexico, you got a situation where the festering sore in America is unemployment, and yet there are approximately 6 to 8 million Mexicans in this country illegally unemployed. They dominate, or increasingly dominate, the politics of the southern tier in 3 or 4 states of the Union, and do so notwithstanding that they speak no English. Mm-hmm. So that it's not necessarily xenophobic to believe, for instance, that you're an English-speaking nation. Hayakawa, who is a Japanese America, is introduced a bill, a constitutional amendment that would declare that we're an English-speaking nation.
It's not necessarily xenophobic. It's not necessarily xenophobic, mm-hmm. But in reality, there is a xenophobic element to these political.
Well, what do you want to deploy that?
But
at the same time, to deploy xenophobia does not mean that I'm hospitable to the notion of giving up whatever ethos it is that we have cultivated here, or whatever common languages or culture we have.
Mr. Buckley, we've talked some about presidential politics. A quick question on congressional politics. I read everything you write. An admission on television. I subscribe to the National Review. Have I missed you ever writing a piece critical of the explosion of legislatively interested money, political action committees, or the explosion of honoraria, which go to candidates or incumbents with strings attached. That is, money is given from people who want votes in Congress, and they're taken by people who know their votes will influence whether they get money. It's a corrupting influence, a lot of people have written. Does that trouble you in terms of the future of our democracy?
Well, it certainly troubles me, and it troubles me whether it's a lobby of the kind that you talk about, or whether it's a labor union, which is obviously trading its support in return for coming after protectionism, whatever. All of these clearly, all of these claims on the attention of a legislator, which gainsay the notion that he's voting for the Commonweal, bother me. But it's probably going to continue.
Well, would you agree with Business Week and editorials saying, let's have for Congress what we have for President, matching public financing to reduce the pressure to take outside money funded by the voluntary tax checkoff?
Well, we have that, don't we?
For presidential, not for congressional. That's the hypocrisy of Congress. Do you think that would reduce the pressure to take these corrupting monies, which we agree distract members of Congress?
I doubt it. I doubt it as a practical matter when you consider how much money is actually being spent by individual candidates. People go out and raise a lot of money. It was Democrats who raised it primarily for 30 or 40 years because the labor unions. Now it's primarily conservatives. I deplore excessive influence of the kind that debases the democratic process. Thank you very much, Mr. Mark Green.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kondracke. Thank you, Mr. Kinsley.
Funding for Firing Line is provided by this station and other public television stations, the Mobile Corporation, John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated, Laurel Foundation, Sunstrand Corporation, and the Friends of Firing Line. This program was produced by SECA, which is solely responsible for its content. For a printed bound transcript of this program, send $2 to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29250. Indicate the subject of the program and please allow 3 weeks for delivery.